the opportunity of nuclear, particularly in our world of AI. How quickly do you think it'll be brought online in the US or indeed the UK? Because your timeline is fast, it seems.
It's aggressive, Caroline, and that's President Trump. You know, he came in all in on nuclear energy, and we will have reactors, these next generation small modular reactors, critical next year. In fact, I'm pretty confident we'll have one of them before July 4th of next year and several more during the year. Now, it's not the back end in electricity production, but it's the whole nuclear system running, demonstrating how it'll work. I think this will expedite final permitting and sales and commercialization of the reactors. It's going to move fast.
Not just fission, but fusion as well. Just how optimistic are you there? 8 to 15 years, I saw. Is that realistic? And how self-dependent would that make the US for, what, 5 gigawatt designs that we're currently seeing just coming from Oracle and OpenAI alone?
Super exciting. I worked on fusion energy in college 40 years ago. And we've seen steady progress for the last 40 years, mostly at the national labs, at the Department of Energy. But with AI and commercial fusion companies coming into space now, the pace of innovation is faster than ever before. Yeah, I believe we will know the commercial pathways to fusion during the Trump administration. And as I said, I think we'll see commercial electricity from fusion energy on could be as fast as 8 years, and I'd be very surprised if it's more than 15. It's coming. It's coming, and it's exciting.
Secretary Wright, as you travel across Europe and head to the UK, what kind of instruction has the president given you to put these energy deals in the context of national security and defense?
I think the president has talked from his campaign that his goal was prosperity at home and peace abroad, and he understands instinctively that both of those are intimately tied to energy. You need low-cost, abundant, affordable energy at home to lower costs for Americans and make businesses thrive. That's the same agenda overseas. Here I am in Europe. They're very, of course, shocked at what happened with the Russia invasion of Ukraine and their energy dependence on Russia. Everybody gets that was a mistake. They want to switch that dependence from Russia onto the United States. We are bringing them assurances we can continue to wrap up natural gas exports into Europe as a safe, secure partner. And, of course, there's huge enthusiasm for American nuclear technology over here. You want to get your energy and your key strategic inputs from your allies, not your adversaries.
When President Trump took office, he pledged to cut electricity price in half. Within 12 months for everyday Americans, Secretary Wright, in the time since the president's been in office, electricity prices have risen 10%. Is he still able to make good on that election pledge, and how does he get there?
Look, the president is a very ambitious, aim-high guy. He is absolutely committed to lowering energy prices in the United States. We've seen that in gasoline and diesel and oil products. We're seeing screaming increase in U.S. natural gas production and prices there as well, not rising at all. Electricity grid's harder. It's just long time frames. Long time frames change that whole system cost. But if you look at it on a micro scale, the president is ready to permit, and we are permitting immediately, electric generating capacity that will be less than half the cost of the stuff that was built under the Biden administration. So are we adding new capacity on the grid that's less than half the cost of the Biden administration? Absolutely. The president's adamant about that. For that to filter in, for the whole grid cost to come down meaningfully, that'll take some time. But rest assured, we're driving as hard and fast as we can.
Secretary Wright, you've been driving hard and fast when it comes to, well, updating, it feels like, the Department of Energy's view on what to use when it comes to energy sources. And in particular, I'm thinking about the thought leadership. Back in July, you put forward what was a report. It was deemed about the threat of climate change and said basically it's exaggerated. Now, that working group has been disbanded. Many have been critical of some of the findings. Do you just still stand by those findings that were ultimately saying a lot of the, well, climate views were wrong about the speed at which the globe is getting hotter, at least?
Actually, no dispute at all about temperature and sea level data. What we did was just popularize the data that the climate alarmists and the politicians don't want to popularize. 90% of what's in our climate report is in the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change reports. I've been studying this issue for 20 years, so quite familiar with it. five fantastic scientists produced that report. And of course, environmental groups that don't want an honest, fact-based dialogue about climate change sued over a silly procedural thing about the paperwork for one of the five. And instead of fighting this in court, the climate scientists, I'm sure they'll still respond to the questions. We've opened a real dialogue about climate change, and that's exactly what we wanted to do. And I couldn't be happier about it. It's funny, I go on more and more shows talking about climate change, and no one wants to ask me any questions about climate change.
Well, I'll keep asking you
if you don't.
You, because why did your department undertake it in such a way? It seemed to that the study wasn't following usual procedures like the OMB's guidelines on science reports.
No, this is when you publish a technical paper, when you publish the paper, that's when the dialogue starts. We wanted to publish. This was from no scientists at DOE, although we did do peer review at DOE. These are five independent scientists that we said, please write a report that just sort of summarizes the big picture about climate change so we can publish it, open it up for public comment. And we've got tons of comments. Now, lots of them are silly, but you can see from the substance of the comments we've received is there's very little disagreement with the data we published on temperature data, sea level data, and models. People are complaining around the edges, or mostly complaining around, but the future might be different. That's true. We don't know the future, but I heard 20 years ago the future might be different. We're just publishing the real data on sea level rise, on temperature increases, on the effects of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, which makes the planet greener, a little bit wetter. Climate change is a real thing, but it's just been so wildly exaggerated and misrepresented. And it's made the climate scientists that go on TV only the most dramatic, alarmist ones that make TV news. Most of the honest, sober ones are in the background. We're bringing them to the forefront.